think what we're going to do is I'll introduce Bryan. He has some introductory thoughts. We'll watch the film. He was based in California and has recently moved here to Utah, which is fortuitous because it's easier for him to speak with us all today. But the other fortuitous thing is I've known Bryan for many years, and I consider him probably one of my best friends. I lived with Bryan in Papua New Guinea for a considerable amount of time. Bryan spent about a year and a half filming for this film, which took place in my home village for my fieldwork. So I have a lot of feelings about this film. When I see people, in this film, I see their whole histories and remember that there's so much that the film captures the beauty of the place and the people. And yet, at the same time, they're fully fleshed people for me. I know all of their gossip and their a lot of the skeletons in the closet. And because of that, I love the film, and because I love the people that are featured in it. Bryan is a documentary filmmaker, like I mentioned, who's won several awards for a lot of his short films and documentary films, including The Bake Shop Ghost, which screened at 80 festivals around the world, won about 20 awards for the best short film. He also has directed music videos and other short films. He went to the Los Angeles Film School, where he produced many of these films, some of which were featured by, one of which was featured by the American Cancer Society. He also had a fellowship at Columbia University's graduate film program. Another exciting thing about this film project is one reason why it looks so nice is that he got some very prestigious grants from Canon as a way to kind of demonstrate the use of their technology in a pretty trying environment. One of the things that you'll hopefully see in the film or get a sense of is that the physical environment of filming here was very, very difficult. There's all power he had to charge with, all batteries had to be charged with solar panels, which sometimes was difficult, especially during the raining season. He did all a lot of film editing there, like in our bush house together. So he did an impressive job under incredibly difficult circumstances. Without further ado, I want to introduce Bryan. You can come here and speak about yourself rather than me butchering it. But the main fact that I want you all to know is that he's one of my best friends. I really love this guy. So thank you, Bryan.
One of the things that I wasn't really prepared for. Was actually how I would kind of feel. this is a work in progress, so the film isn't yet completed. So this is really the first time that in a public setting such as this, portions of the film will be shared. But I'm just like, I'm looking up at this face. This is Duma Henny. Sorry. I wasn't ready for that. But what has hit me is something that I would often hear in the village, and I'm sure Jordan can attest to this. A gold mine, the Misima gold mine came and spent about 15, 18 years roughly mining gold ore from the island. There's a lot of the good things about it, a lot of bad things about it. I don't really have to make an opinion on it right now, but one of the things that I took away from my experience in the village is that when the mine left and the jobs and the kind of the new way of living in the village, one of the things that they said a lot was, we feel like we were forgotten. They were left behind. The mine came and then left. So I'm just kind of working through the feelings of, in this, in a weird kind of way, this moment is us remembering them. And maybe for the first time, some of you actually getting to know Papua New Guinea and then in the film, what it's like to live in a village, live on their island, and their way of life, etc. So I wasn't prepared, but I just feel like I wanted to share that because I'm just gonna keep choking up. Anyway, as Jordan said, my name is Bryan Pitcher, and I am the director and producer of the documentary film Misima. And I'd like to thank the Department of Anthropology, Dr. Jordan Haug, for inviting me to come and be here with you today. I really love this work, and I hope that my experiences... You didn't prepare me for this, Jordan. You said just come and talk about the project. But I hope... I'm usually not. I was pretty stoic when I was on the island. I don't think I cried maybe once. But it's just weird because I can see the through line in the connection. And in a weird sort of way, I wish Duma knew that this was happening today. But I do love the work. And I hope that my experiences living in a village and making this film will be beneficial to you and to the discussion we hope to have today. I'd like to quickly acknowledge Brooke Denton, who's here in the audience. She's an associate producer on the film. And she's here along with several generous financial donors to the project. And so for the outsiders who are here today, thank you for coming and for your continued support. And then he didn't mention it, but Dr. Jordan Haug is the content advisor on the film. And so it's through him that, I mean, obviously he just said we're really good friends, but it's through him that I am a guest presenter this afternoon. So thank you. Thank you for welcoming me. And I hope you enjoy the program. You know, I did say that it's a work in progress. And that just means that it lacks final sound mix, color correction, original music composition. The music you'll hear today is experimental, it's temporary, and will eventually be replaced. But there's enough footage here today that I think it will spark an interesting conversation about the similarities and differences of ethnographic fieldwork and documentary filmmaking. And maybe before we dim the lights, I'll just tell you a little bit about the story. So as you know, the film takes place on the island of Misima in Papua New Guinea. And we have a Papua New Guinean here. She is from the Milbane province, which is where this film takes place. But it documents the daily struggles that women encounter on the island. And one of these women is Dumaheni. She boldly pursues a quest to assert more authority as an emerging clan leader and then tackle the challenge of single motherhood. Her story to me really demonstrates how the long, long shadow of the now closed Misima gold mine has impacted their traditional culture. Her perseverance, and through her perseverance, Duma begins to document her genealogical ancestry and then build a case to defend her land tenure rights at a local land court. If the film is successful, I hope it will use her journey to illustrate some of the new kinds of legal and economic logics that Misimans are now being coerced into living under. Ultimately, Misiman women, like Duma, are really just trying to assert their traditional authority that has been eroded from them through the gold mine and on its influence in the local economy, politics, and gender norms. So I think that's enough to get us going. We'll screen 34 minutes of the film. It's intended to be feature length, which is usually like 106 minutes, if not longer. So I've really had to like squish it down. You're gonna be kind of rushed through the narrative in some portions. But for the sake of today's conversation, and maybe to kind of help inspire Jordan and I, I've left in some really extended scenes where we really linger in the story world. For example, in the garden, there's a night clan meeting where you're gonna hear a lot of repetition and kind of get a good sense, you know, like how they're repetitive they are and how they kind of talk. So without further ado, let's take a look.
When coming to the garden, I come by myself. It's not easy working in the garden by myself. We make gardens on the mountains because Liak don't have much of the flatland. For my little girl, Caribbean, who is now 16 years old. Hey, mama.
Hey, mama.
The very special thing that makes me love her the most is because in our tradition, culture, we go on the mother's side. I know that she'll be the one that she'll be inheriting the land of the clan that I belong to. I was 19 years old when I got married to one of the men in Liak. At the time, he was working for Misima Mines, and when the company came, it was the first of its kind, a big company coming onto the island, and it changed the atmosphere. What happens if I don't win? I feel that it will be a great loss. And to my daughter, she will say to me that I don't love her. Because this is the very time that if we win, she will take her land back. But if we don't win, then the land will go to the other clan.
So it's today that we're gonna have our case. Land dispute.
Thank you.
wish my daughter is here to help me.
In the Misima tradition, it is believed that the women are not as bright as men. Men are the ones that they are to be the front people.
One of the reasons why I wanted to have Bryan here is that some of you may not realize that the method of documentary filmmaking that he engaged in is vastly different from like what you're going to see like in like Vice News or something, right? Like, where essentially people, what they do is, you know, you have a professional crew that flies in for a weekend and like interviews a bunch of people in West Virginia about why they like Trump or something like that, right? And instead, Bryan's method was very similar to how we think of anthropology, of the value of taking things slow. And he went through many false starts. That's not too too critical to say, right?
No.
Yeah.
I mean, I had a lot of successes and a lot of failures there, and I mean that's part of the challenge, right?
So yeah.
Whether you're a filmmaker or an ethnographic field worker, you know, you're going to be following threads of interest or pursuing, you know, your interest or, you know, on your subjects or whatever, and sometimes they just lead to dead ends.
Yeah.
Or sometimes everyone's interested in it. There's all kinds of stories.
I was always struck by watching him that our differences, huge differences in how we conducted our research my method was to fade into the background. The less people noticed me, the better. And Bryan's method was kind of the opposite. And it worked out for both of us in good ways, but I always was struck by how much, even though our differences in personality and some of our methods, we shared a lot of the same ethic of anthropology, which is that it takes time. And the most important thing was to kind of follow what people had to say about the subject, right? Like, we both wanted to do research around the mind.
Yes, and that was the impetus.
Yeah, and that's not what people wanted to talk about. You get in the film a little bit, but instead they wanted to talk about these land disputes and various other things. Without stop hearing from me. Bryan has lots of thoughts about this, and then we can go to questions and answers.
Yeah, you know, I mean, there's so much I could talk about, but I'm trying to think from your point of view, like, what would be helpful. You know, you go into a project, you know, you have your impetus, you have what, you know, strikes at the heart chords. But then, as Jordan mentioned, you know, the impetus was to go and look at the long-term effects of the gold mine. And in essence, I did do that, but it's not like in a very exaggerated way. In America, when I was preparing in pre-production, you know, I went through, read a lot of articles, I had lots of conversations with Jordan. I've read other research papers from people who had studied in the area and with a focus on like women's issues, etc. But then, as Jordan said, you get there, and then like the first 3 weeks, you've pretty much heard everything everyone has to say about the mine, because it is like the first thing you kind of ask about, because it's the driving force of why you're even there. And then you realize you've covered all of the, it's almost like politics. Once all the rhetoric gets covered, they just become repeated talking points, and then it suddenly becomes extremely boring. And on top of that, you're pursuing a topic of something that's already happened in the past. So it's very hard to capture that in a visual medium such as film. So how do you capture the impacts of a mine? What does that really look like? So I had to regroup and look deeper. And therein lies another big lesson of ethnographic fieldwork and filmmaking as well, if you're interested in this kind of filmmaking. is to stay really curious and to listen to the people, listen to what they're talking about. Stop hyper-focusing on what you're trying to pursue, and then just kind of let it go. And so the first 3 months that I was there, I just spent a lot of time visiting with people. I did carry my camera around and film every day. That was part of my kind of my boot camp structure, is to stay very disciplined about waking up every day and walking out with my backpack where I carried my camera. And then this is a bit of a tangent, but I didn't work alone. In the flyer, you see me sitting in the bush behind the camera, but there's a gentleman to my right, his name's Mark Joel, and he was basically my assistant director for the entire time that I was there. And he did some of the translation work and also taught me some of the local phrases and such. So I wasn't alone, but we would both put our backpacks on and go out every morning. I just spent a lot of time visiting, filming people, asking them, you know, who would ever be interested in sitting down and talking with me, either on or off camera, asking them about their life. And so essentially what I was doing was, in Hollywood terms, it would be the casting phase. But really what I was trying to do is find the heart of my story. Who would be the protagonist, or maybe there was a couple. And I ended up honing in on three women, and Duma was one of them. And then you realize that there's more to life than just bad-mouthing the gold mine. And so you sort of have to rewrite. And I guess that's just a customary part of field work. Maybe Jordan, on the ethnographic field side, can talk about you know, how he had to kind of shift gears a little bit. And so being willing to kind of freestyle and improv and be flexible, then you'll be able to kind of find the new story threads and then see how they can still tie into the impetus. But as I moved forward, you know, the impetus just kind of faded further and further into the background. And it really became about Duma's two quests. You know, her separation from her daughter, and is she gonna be able to get her daughter back? How is she gonna overcome and build up the courage and put her foot down and be like, I want my daughter back. And then her other quest was winning the land dispute. And then that motivated her character arc, her growth as a protagonist, to, you know, break through some of the taboos of sitting behind the men, you know, the social norms on the island, and being an obedient village woman, as it were, and begin to speak out as she really began to reach up and connect with her ancestor, Sinikepu. I really felt strongly that there was kind of a rebirth of energy in her to be like women on the land. It didn't really come through very clear in the film. I think twice in this version of the film, you hear her say that in Misima tradition, we go on the mother's side. And that's just a very easy way of saying it's a matrilineal culture. And so the land does get passed down from mother to daughters. The sons don't inherit anything. They have to go off and marry someone to have access to land. And that's an incentive, I guess, for men to marry and form families. I don't know. Jordan can correct me, but that was my takeaway. And so the men leave their home village and go live with the women whom they marry and live under the thumb of their in-laws and work the land. And then once they're done, you know, in their elderly years, you know, the land is supposed to return back to the women always. The men are just kind of guests. So Duma really, you know, I just kind of grabbed the reins with that. And she's not the only one. You heard Uncle Patrick. Uncle Patrick was the older elder of the Mesoga clan at the end. And he kind of gave what he wants for the next generation, his 1, 2, 3 best case scenario. But I had some interesting conversations with him. So this wasn't lost on men or women, but this idea of women having this traditional authority or of a balance of power with their male counterparts was sort of kind of skewed. Through the activity of the gold mine and the hyper-employment that the men experienced, and being educated and pulled out of the village and kind of these migrant mine workers to the south coast of the island. And but they were always talking about customary law. You know, before the missionaries came, before the mine came, I don't know who else intruded on their space, but it was mostly the missionaries and then, you know, prospectors. You know, changed the ideas around some of these customary traditions. And I guess because of the cash economy, you know, and having quick access to rice and tinned fish and, you know, convenience foods, basically, that were imported onto the island for all of the mine workers that came in from Australia. They're like, wow, cool. I don't have to go sweat so hard in the garden. I could just take my paycheck and buy some food. And I didn't spend a lot of time in this research, so this might be something you might, if you're curious about it, you can ask Jordan. But I did sort of get the sense that there suddenly was kind of like the Starbelly Sieges, haves and have-nots. And even some local men in the village had enough money, they would just hire other people to go work in their gardens, which was kind of an unusual thing, as you saw in the opening scene in this film, that, you know, it really was a group effort. Anyway, so being flexible as an ethnographic field worker in your research, being patient to find the people who are not just going to be giving you propaganda or what they think you want to hear is really important, so that you can actually get down, peel back the layers of the onion and begin to really look at life from their unique perspective. And it's sort of, sometimes I think of it sort of like a crime scene, a forensic scene. You kind of want to, I go in with my camera, and you know, Jordan would always give me a hard time about how I would just kind of go up to people and put the camera in their faces. I really wanted to get those shots, you know. But even though I know that that was sort of intrusive, because I was there for so long, they just, I mean, I just kind of became like a mosquito, right? They just kind of got used to the dim-dim, which is their word for like the foreigner or the white guy. So they just, oh, the dim-dim, yeah, the dim-dim. And so the village became accustomed to me, and that is something that you have to earn. And I suppose that it's similar in ethnographic field work, that you have to kind of earn your spot to be there. People aren't just gonna open their door and just give you what you want, because it's just too transactional. Depending on where you go, I mean, in America, everybody loves a good transaction. So just name your price, right? But when you're working in this kind of an environment, you do have to earn their trust and earn your right to be there. And then over time, they begin to open up. And he mentioned Vice News, Jordan, and how they do really quick, short programs or whatever. But I just knew that that wouldn't be possible in my case. You spent, I think, what, 19 months? 20 months? 22. Wow, so it's even longer than I remember. So you do sort of have to pay the price for that information. And in my case, I was more than happy to pay it. I really enjoyed my time on the village. And but then once you get down there, forensically, you're kind of moving around with the camera, but you don't really want to disturb stuff. You don't want to disturb them. You don't really want to implant your ideas too much. I was reprimanded a couple times by Jordan. At the very, very beginning, just sitting around talking to men and saying all kinds of things. And then I realized, ooh, you know, I should listen more. And that was really helpful.
Well, there's just a couple of things I wanted to mention about the film. Before the question answers. From this cut, it's not totally clear, but in other cuts, it is more clear about what happens in the end. And so I should kind of tell you, Bryan could do it, but I'll do it quickly, which is nothing works out. And for me, one of the things that is frustrating about that for the Western viewer is that that feels like that's, we demand narrative closure as Western viewers. But that's just not what life is like, you know? Things don't work out. And often things like are just infinitely left open. For me, when Bryan got back for the last time, Bryan actually went back to Misima after I had come home for the last time.
Yeah, I think we only overlapped like 5 months.
Yeah. So Bryan, when he came back, he was kind of in a, not a panic, but like upset of like, oh, you know, this didn't work out. And I was like, perfect. That's great. Good. And it just conveys a life in Misima very, very well. There's another shot that it was not present in this cut that I like a lot. Maybe he cut it for time reasons, but this really long scene of them just kind of waiting to find out that they came there for no reason at all. That's kind of what's happening. And it demands a lot for a Western viewer. Bryan and I both feel that this very much captures what life in Papua New Guinea can be like, which is a lot of waiting and often a lot of disappointment with that.